I got off of Facebook. I got off of Twitter. I also got off of LinkedIn. I'm not on any social media at all.
안녕하세요, 박사님. 어떻게 지내셨어요?
Oh, I've been great. Thank you for having me. I have fond memories about your forum.
그때 당시를 어떻게 기억하시는지 궁금합니다.
I remember it being incredibly impressive.
Pretended that the mortgages were not risky. It suited our purposes in finance.
Yeah, it was very thoughtful time for me, and I appreciated the opportunity to come. To Seoul and to speak to you.
선거철이 있을 때 특별히 더 이 소셜 미디어의 데이터를 우리가 조심해야 된다라고 경고를 하셨었는데요. 미국도 지금 대선이 있는 상황인데 그때에 비해서 좀 개선된 게 있는지 모르겠습니다.
No. Did we have no improvement? I think we've gone backwards in a few ways, I would say, in terms of addressing this. The first way is that the technology has just simply gotten much more advanced. I remember deep fakes, which is to say the technology that would allow you to take a video of President Obama speaking about climate change and just change his words and make him say something else and look realistic. That technology, the deep fake technology, has proliferated and gotten really good, and now it's being used for political purposes. And then the other thing is that Meta, that owns Facebook, and other social media, and it also owns Instagram, we have the actors who are just not interested in addressing this and don't want it to be their problem. And I'm not saying Meta has done nothing, but it hasn't done enough. And so we should very much expect, and we are already seeing, we have plenty of evidence right now, that political ads are manipulating people into false information. I think that the one bright spot is that I think some people are slightly aware of the problem, so they don't believe everything they see. But enough people are susceptible and vulnerable to bad information and misinformation that it is a serious problem.
그 말씀하신 것처럼 상황이 더 악화되고 있다면 우리가 무엇을 해야 될까요?
I think the best opportunity would be to allow social science researchers, as I said in 2018, allow more research and more understanding of the landscape of what's really happening. A technology like maybe the car, the invention of the car. And I'm sure the car was very exciting when it was first invented. But the good thing about the car was that its risks were also relatively evident. The individual risks, because you could see people getting into car crashes and dying. And that was just by the side of the road, like somebody died. Whereas with the algorithms, the massive at-scale algorithms, like what we're talking about on social media, the harms are invisible or they're harder to measure.
박사님께서도 소셜미디어를 이용하는지 궁금해요.
I'm not on any social media at all. I got off of Facebook after Trump got elected in 2016, and I saw so much craziness. And then I got off of Twitter the day that Elon Musk announced he was buying it because I saw a few miles away what he was like, and I'm really glad not to be there. So I'm not on any social media, and I realized that some people don't have the privilege to get off of all social media. Sometimes it's actually a requirement for your job or to get a job. So I know I'm lucky to be able to do that. But yeah, it's improved my life to be off of social media.
한국에 그 수포자라는 말이 있어요. AI 시대에 사실 수학이 점점 중요해지고 있는데 우리 어떻게 하면 수학을 좀 좋아할 수 있을지 조언을 좀 부탁드릴게요.
Mathematics, of course. To answer your question, it's extremely beautiful to me. It's like art. It's like poetry as something that's beautiful and something that's mysterious. artistic and creative, then it wouldn't just be sort of trying to memorize, because of course that's not mathematics to me. So I would suggest thinking about mathematics that isn't important at all, that is just for fun. So I guess what I would say is be more like a child. Be childish, be playful, be whimsical, and think of things as a game. Because mathematics is like, it's at its best when it is play. But I don't want it to be the case that, you know, we all need to become mathematicians in order to navigate the modern technology. I think it would be, if we all were required to learn something, it would probably be more like philosophy or ethics or the history of technology. Those are topics that I think we would benefit from understanding, like how things are actually affecting us.
데이터나 알고리즘 관련해서 우리가 더 조심해야 되거나 좀 들여다봐야 되는 게 있다면 무엇이라고 생각하나요?
The biggest risk is that we endow these new technologies with the notion of consciousness, which they absolutely do not enjoy. Whereas we shouldn't trust them because they're not people, they're not conscious. This is for me the alarm I would raise now, which is like, look, follow the money. Don't be tricked into thinking that you're talking to a conscious machine, because that's a science fiction story that they want you to think about.
대량 살상 그 수학 무기에 이어서 이제는 이제 그 수치심에 대해서 관심을 갖고 계신데요. 어떻게 그 관심이 수치심으로 넘어갔는지 궁금합니다.
I think of this as a very similar kind of book. It's about how social media has, not just social media, but in particular social media, has sort of superpowered the already existing sort of toxic qualities of for-profit shame. Social media is in fact a shame-driven environment that actually the companies make money from us being on social media and staying there and becoming addicted to it in large part because it's shaming. And whether that's because we are ashamed or we get addicted to shaming other people, either way, it's the big tech companies that are making money from it.
수치심하고 혐오와의 관계는 좀 어떻게 보시는지 궁금해요.
Part of the first part of sort of the effects of social media on shame is that it grew groups apart. When you get far enough apart, then the norms are different. So once we have really different norms, but we're continuing to shame each other, it's no longer about trying to come up with a compromise or trying to figure out how to unite the norms. Once again, very explicitly designed to provoke us into fighting, to stay on social media and to click on those ads for their profit, for their bottom line. So it's a for-profit design that gets us to hate each other.
그러면 이 상황을 좀 바꿔보고 싶으면 무엇을 해야 될까요?
Well, it's a great question. I mean, first, we do have common grounds. Like, there's all sorts of universal norms that we do agree on, but we are constantly being coaxed and almost forced into the conversations about the things we don't agree on. So that's a design thing as well. But my point is that, like, for the most part, the goal of an algorithm on social media is to figure out what we disagree on and make us talk about that. I remember back in the day when we didn't have to know everyone's opinion on everything, right? But now we somehow have to know that. I think our younger people are, because they have to be, because they're constantly swarmed with all these things that other people disagree about, they just get used to it. They get used to not agreeing with other people. We can choose to say, yeah, we don't agree on this, but I don't care. We have to get used to it because it's not going away. So the question is, do we invest our life's energy into hating each other? Or do we just accept that people disagree on things and move on and try to find our universal norms?
저희 STF가 올해 20주년을 맞았는데요. 축하의 메시지 좀 부탁드릴게요.
Yes, congratulations SBS Forum on 20 years of success and really truly interesting, thoughtful conversations. It's just an extreme honor to be part of it. You're one of my favorite journalists to speak to. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
우리가 미래에 이 키워드 하나 정도는 우리가 좀 앞서 고민해야 된다라는 게 있다면 어떤 건지 하나 적어서 좀 보여주시겠어요?
이시다. We spent the last 30 years with technology becoming further apart. So like let's figure out how to connect closer and to find our universal norms and our universal love, you know, which is to say the things that we can all admire.
감사합니다. STF 20년의 기록 미래를 본 사람들 오늘은 캐시오닐 박사님과 함께 했는데요. 같이 해 주셔서 너무 감사합니다.